1 Corinthians chapter 8 again, and to continue on from where we left off last night. We got to know the Corinthian ecclesia a little bit last night and the challenges that were confronting them and the way the apostle was teaching them how to think through these problems that confront ecclesial life. And what we discovered was that our brothers and sisters in Corinth lived in an immoral city that had this great mountain, the Acrocorinthus, overshadowing the city, both physically and also morally, because on top of that mountain there was an idol temple that dominated the culture of the city. And it was steeped in paganism and immorality, and there were 1,000 prostitutes involved in the ministrations to Astarte, the goddess and patroness of harlots. And the whole city was steeped in idolatry. And part of the culture of the city was to offer animal sacrifices to this idol, and they would give some meat to the idol and burn it as a burnt offering, and then there would be a meal of fellowship that was held up on that mountain and in the temples around about Corinth. And so that meal of fellowship, the sharing in the meat, was just that, a sharing with the idol in the culture of everything that idol represented. And then some of the meat would be sold in the meat markets. And so the big question that was being asked in chapter 8 was, how should the brothers and sisters in Corinth deal with this meat that was part of the goods that were on sale in the marketplace? And they found their way onto the meal tables of the Corinthians and also some of the brothers and sisters in the ecclesia. And there were two views, and they were expressed in very extreme terms. And the extreme views on this issue mirrored, in some ways, the schools of philosophical thought that these Corinthians had grown up with and had been taught since childhood. We saw that the two extremes of Greek philosophy, which Paul met in both Athens and in Corinth, were the Epicurean view of life, and the Epicureans were a school of philosophers coming from Epicurus, who advocated moral liberty and indulgence in pleasure. So whatever it is, good food, good wine, good restaurants, good lifestyle, immorality even, just indulge. If you have an appetite for it, God's given you that appetite. The pagan God has given you that appetite. You've been born with it. It's part of who we are. And if we have the means to satisfy it, then go ahead and enjoy. And so they encouraged indulgence. That was the Epicureans. On the other extreme, and they are extremes, these two positions, amongst the pagans in Corinth, there was the Stoics, who advocated moral discipline and deprivation of pleasure. And so both of these words have come into the English language, Epicure and Stoicism, representing these two philosophical schools of thought. And they very much impacted the way the brothers and sisters polarised over this issue of meats offered to idols. And so we talk about the Epicureans, or the Libertines on the one hand, who strongly said, it's no problem to eat the meat offered to idols, it's just meat, it's unchanged, what's the issue? There is no issue. On the other side of things, there were the Stoical brethren who said, look, we should not be getting involved in anything to do with paganism, anything to do with idolatry, and meat, even if it's been near the temple or offered there, we should not be indulging. And many of the brothers who had escaped from paganism and come to the truth felt that by indulging in this meat that had been offered to idols, by putting it on their meal tables, they were bringing back, in their minds at least, all the memories and associations and allegiances that they had had in their former pagan lifestyle. And so this was a real issue, and the Libertines had written to Paul as part of the letter of questions that they had addressed to Paul, who was, when he was writing this in Ephesus, and they said to Paul, look, please provide an answer. Should we eat the meat or not? Please just give us some guidance on this issue. And the apostle proceeded to in chapters 8, 9 and 10, and that's this whole section of Corinthians that we're looking at. But it was not a one-word answer that he proposed to give. He starts systematically modelling how we should address ecclesial issues when there's disagreements. And in this seemingly innocuous issue, this seemingly unimportant issue, the apostle models to us how we should deal with one another when we confront issues of disagreement amongst ourselves. And so that was the breakdown that we started on last night. We got through to about verse 7, which is where we're going to take it up from. But in verse 1, the structure of it set the tenor of the thoughts Paul was putting forward here. Now, as touching things offered unto idols, the Corinthians had this catch cry, "We know that we all have knowledge," said the Corinthian libertine. And so they advocated their own position very strongly and said, "We all understand this." And they said, really, everyone understands it the same way. And they overstated the situation. And so when we come to verse 7, we find that the apostle expresses more closely to the facts what was actually going on. He says in verse 7, "But there is not in every man that knowledge." So the way you, Corinthian libertine, has presented your understanding of the issue, it's not the way everyone in your ecclesia sees it. To suggest that everyone really just sees it the same way is to oversimplify the situation in the Corinthian ecclesia. For he goes on to say, "Some with conscience of the idol unto this hour eat it as a thing offered unto an idol, and their conscience being weak is defiled." And so the apostle says, this is a real issue in your meeting. And I am aware from reports that I've heard over here in Ephesus that very recently there have been people expressing grave concerns on this issue of meats offered to idols. And this word defiled means to soil or make dirty. And so these stoical brethren, these brethren with a sensitive conscience, which is what a weak conscience in this context means, on this issue it was a weak conscience, brittle, easily offended. They felt that they were dirty, that they were doing something impure, they were acting unfaithfully towards Christ if they ate this meat that had been offered in the idol temple. And so it was serious for them. And so the apostle then goes through a couple of arguments, if you like, puts some propositions to the libertine brother who is strongly advocating the fact that we should just eat the meat and stop making an issue of it. And the first of these arguments is in verse 8. He puts this to the Corinthian libertine to make them think about their conduct and the way they were behaving. He says to the Corinthian libertine, "But meat commendeth us not to God. For neither if we eat are we the better, neither if we eat not are we the worse." And so what the apostle is saying here is, and he's sort of saying to the libertine, look, you're trying to downplay the issue. You're trying to say, oh, it's not that important. Everyone really understands it. These weak brethren, they're just making an issue over nothing. They're amplifying a small issue to a big issue. Really, we all understand that it's just meat. Let's just get on with eating it and move on to something more important. But what the apostle does here is he's saying, well, that's interesting that you're downplaying the meat. It's not that important to you. And so he says, well, actually, it's true in a sense. Meat doesn't commend us to God, really. It's not what we eat that's going to commend us to God. Because if we eat it, we're no better. If we don't eat it, we're not worse. Therefore, the implication he's drawing out for the libertine is this. It won't be a great issue for you then not to eat it, to abstain from it for the sake of your brother. And so he just puts to the libertine this issue that if you want to downplay its importance, then that's a two-edged sword. Because the way I view it, says Paul, is if it's not that important to you, then it won't be a big thing for you to abstain from it then. And that's his first argument to the libertine in the way he should be thinking about conducting himself. And then he moves on. In verse 9. And he moves to his second argument. "But take heed, lest by any means this liberty of yours become a stumbling block to them that are weak." You'll notice this idea of "by any means." I want you to take heed. Think about it carefully. "Lest by any means," even if there is the slightest danger or possibility of you insisting on your right to eat meat and that leading to the downfall of your brother, you need to think very carefully about it. This word liberty means, it's the Greek word ecclesia, and it means a privilege, a power, a right that you might assert that you think you've got the right to do something, the power to do something. You're exercising your free will to do something. This is the kind of idea that's carried through by this word liberty. It's a freedom, but it's more than a freedom. It's right. It's a right. Who are you to tell me that I can't eat the meat offered to idols? I've got a right to eat it. We're free in Christ, and so I am going to do it regardless of what you think. Well, I suppose rationally speaking, that might be true, that you can do whatever you like. You can make your own choices and so on. But really, in Christ, is that the argument we should be making to justify and excuse our conduct that might be having negative effects upon others? Paul says that exercising this right that you think you have, this liberty that you're going to insist upon and assert, may lead to be a stumbling block for those who have a more sensitive conscience on this matter. This word stumbling block literally means a stub or something sticking out of the ground where someone who is not paying attention, who's walking along, may trip over that thing that's sticking out of the ground and really fall and do themselves some serious damage. And so figuratively it stands for something that leads to apostasy, something that leads to someone losing the faith, something over which someone falls to their spiritual detriment. It could be the issue which destroys the faith of your brother or sister. The issue. And it's a serious consideration all of a sudden. So the one minute you're saying it's not important, the libertine is saying it's not important, you know, this is not a big issue, it's nothing. All of a sudden the apostle says, well, hang on. You may have that view for yourself, but how does your brother and sister see this same issue? Put yourself in their shoes. Try to see life through their eyes. And surely this is one of the big thinking, spiritual thinking skills and habits of mind we should be developing, isn't it? To be able to look through our brother's or our sister's eyes at life and the matter at hand, and not just see it through our own eyes, but to try to show empathy and try to show understanding and an awareness of the background of the other person that you might be dealing with and why they might be thinking the way they're thinking. This is selfless love. This is showing love when you try to understand the other person and the view that they may be taking and why they're taking it, why it's important to them, rather than just insisting upon what we think is right and asserting our rights and freedoms to the detriment of others. This is what the apostle is trying to get this libertine brother and sister to see. This word stumbling block occurs in the Septuagint, and the first time it occurs is in Exodus 23. It's in the context of the Israel at Sinai. It's in the context of just having received the Ten Commandments and Moses about to go up in the mountain for 40 days. And you might remember that while Moses was up on the mountain, they reverted to paganism. They built an idol. They said, Moses is away. He's not coming back. And it was Aaron, you might remember, that says, let's make a feast unto Yahweh. And they collected all the gold up and they made a golden calf. They just escaped from Egypt. And they reverted back to paganism so quickly. Such is the danger of idolatry and all that's associated with it. It was evident in Israel coming out of Egypt. It's clearly evident here to the Corinthians. And so the apostle keeps raising the wilderness generation for this Corinthian ecclesia because the example was there for them of the danger of reverting back to idolatry and how that might seem initially to be innocuous or, you know, not very dangerous, but for the wilderness generation, it led to their ruin. And so it could for the Corinthians. And this word stumbling block occurs here in the Septuagint in Exodus 23. You know, God says, I will set thy bounds from the Red Sea even to the Sea of the Philistines, from the desert to the river. I will deliver the inhabitants of the land into your hand, and you will drive them out before thee. Thou shalt make no covenant with them nor their gods. When you go into the land, there's to be no covenant or agreement made. There's to be no negotiation. There's no conciliation to be made. You are to make no agreement with them nor with their gods. They shall not dwell in your land, lest they make you sin against me. For if you serve their gods, it will surely be a snare unto thee. This word snare is this same word stumbling block that's taken up by the apostle here. And it has a proven track record of bringing spiritual ruin to generations of Israelites in times past. The Corinthians were going to fall for the same trap. if they weren't careful. By indulging in worldliness and idolatry and the immorality that's associated with the lifestyle package that the world has to offer, which is crystallised in idolatry but extends into a whole way of life that the Corinthians knew all about. And that's why that sensitive brother had that perspective on the meats offered to idols. That's why that sensitive brother and sister have felt so strongly about this issue. And so the apostle is just throwing that illusion in there to awaken a broader understanding, perhaps, of where this might lead for the Corinthian libertine brother. For, he goes on to say in verse 10, if any man see thee which hast knowledge, sit at meat in the idol's temple, shall not the conscience of him who is weak be emboldened to eat those things which are offered to idols? Now you'll notice there's a subtle shift here in what's going on. So I was discussing this with someone last night. At the start of chapter 8, it's eating meat offered to idols and in your own home. Buying the meat in the meat markets, bringing it home and eating it. Is that okay? Well, what the apostle does here is he makes a subtle shift and he says, this is not just about that, is it? You see, the Corinthian libertine here is to be seen in the idol temple, in the restaurant there where the food was dished up, enjoying a meal in the idol temple. And the restaurants that were ancillary to that building. And there would have been music and dancing and drinking and food and, you know, all the good restaurants were there. All the money was there. It would have been beautifully set up, all built out of marble and stone. And it would have been quite an exceptional environment. All the money of Corinth was poured into that place. But now it's not just a matter of the Corinthian libertine eating meats off of the idols, but he's there. He's walked up that mountain. He's sitting with friends eating a meal. And so the apostle just explains how this is a progression. He does it subtly here and just introduces the idea that he knows there's more going on than just the meat of two idols. But he says, the conscience of him that is weak is emboldened by your conduct and your example to eat those things which he finds defiling. And so the poor brother, the pagan brother that's left paganism behind, he's been taught the things of the truth. He realises how important it is not to associate with idols. He was taught that as he was taught the truth. And once being baptised, it was quite a struggle to leave those things that were part of his life beforehand behind, all the temptations of that lifestyle he had to live with every day and had to fight every day. And so he's tried to rule that out of his life. He's tried to excise those things from his life. And he's trying to live a godly life. And he looks one day and he sees brother so-and-so walking up the mountain to the idol temple. Or he walks past the temple in the midst of Corinth and he looks in and there's brother so-and-so sitting in the idol temple eating a meal, eating the meat that had just been offered to the idols. And he might have been sitting there with friends and family and so on. And all of a sudden it's like, whoa, I thought we didn't do that. I thought brothers in Christ didn't do that. Maybe I didn't quite understand things properly. And so his understanding, his conscience on these issues is all of a sudden thrown into confusion. And the brother overrides the conscience that has been awakened to spiritual ideas. And he overrides it and says, well, maybe it's okay. I can go back and do that stuff. And that leads him straight back into the pathway of paganism, which had been so difficult for him to leave and escape from. Just like Israel at Mount Sinai, they fell straight back into that lifestyle. It says, they sat down to eat and drink, and then they rose up to play. And so it wasn't just the eating and the drinking, this was a whole lifestyle package which involved all kinds of things, including immorality. It was just part and parcel of what was going on. And so this brother's insistence of his right to eat meat was also seen now to be his insistence to go to that particular place and eat a meal, which was now causing great problems for this brother with a sensitive conscience on the issue. And then he says in verse 11, and through your knowledge, you understand the issue, you understand that an idol is nothing, you understand therefore that that place where that you're eating that meal really is is a shell of a place. The idol's nothing. It's no problem to you, you argue. And through your knowledge, the weak brother is led down a pathway to spiritual ruin. What an outcome. What a sad outcome. Now, this word perish, of course, means they lose the kingdom. What an absolute tragedy. And then he says here, "For your weak brother perish, for whom Christ died." This is one of the most beautiful and most powerful little phrases in the Bible. For whom Christ died. There's so much power in that little phrase. Through your knowledge and insistence on your technically correct view of what an idol is and what it isn't, and therefore what the meat is and what it isn't, and your rational arguments about whether you can and can't do this thing, through your knowledge and the absence of love, shall the weak brother perish for whom Christ died. There's a few points we can take from this little phrase. The first is this: Christ sacrificed everything for that brother. Christ gave everything. He didn't just give up the right to eat meat, which even out of the libertine's mouth, they acknowledged it's a small issue. He gave his life for the good of his brethren. How small a sacrifice it would be then for you just not to buy sacred meat, but to source food from other sources. Can you not make that small sacrifice for your brother when Christ was prepared to die for that same brother? The second thing I draw from this little phrase, for whom Christ died, is that if we refuse to make sacrifices of this kind for our brethren and sisters, we place ourselves in status above Christ. We're really saying, I'm more important than Christ. The things that I want to do are more important than things that he could have done if he'd ignored our needs. You see, the same point was made in the sacrifice of Christ in the upper room, in the washing of the disciples' feet. You know, they were all there arguing about who's going to be the greatest. And Jesus entered the room and there was a bowl of water and a towel, and no one had picked it up to do the customary washing of feet. So Jesus girded the towel and he took the bowl and he started washing the disciples' feet, which caused great consternation. You're not washing my feet, says Peter. And the others also felt this sense of humiliation. And after that job was done, the slave's job, the Lord said, do you know what I've just done? Do you understand what I've just done? He says, if I, being your Lord and Master, have washed your feet, what should you do for one another? If I, your Lord and Master, have done that, and you acknowledge that I'm your Lord and Master, you call me that, if I've taken up a towel and washed your feet, what should you be prepared to do for one another? Even more. And so the Lord taught us that we should be prepared to serve. We should be prepared to sacrifice for the good of our brothers and sisters and putting their needs before our own. This brother that you are running roughshod over, Christ died for. Another aside about this little phrase, it's actually one of the select few passages in the New Testament which we should greatly value, because it clearly teaches that what Christ did for all mankind as an aggregate, he also did for every individual personally. This is an important point to understand. Sometimes we're sitting here in the hall and we look around and we think, well, there's a whole lot of brothers and sisters here doing better than I am. I'm struggling in the truth. I'm struggling to maintain the faith. And I can understand Christ dying for all these people in the room, but, you know, if it was just me, I think it would have been a waste of time. And he wouldn't have done it. He probably wouldn't have done it. I wouldn't have been important enough. What Paul is drawing out here is that one single brother that you are treating badly, Christ died for that individual. And so it's teaching us that Christ would die for one, not just die for all. And Christ died for that individual that you're treating badly. Now, if you need that encouragement, draw this strength from it, that if there were no one else to die from, Christ would have died for you. How should we behave, therefore, in response to that? And so as we interact with one another in ecclesial life, remember when we say a harsh word or think an evil thought against brother A or sister B, that Christ takes that very personally, because Christ died for that brother and that sister. Now, the next point that follows on from this is made very explicitly. So and it's this one, that we are one with our Lord. What we do to a brother, we do to Christ. This is pretty powerful. Whatever you do to a brother and a sister, you do to Christ. Pretend Christ is standing in their place. Because every time you speak to a brother or sister in this hall, whether it be a word of encouragement, showing a word of support, bringing a glass of water to someone in need, to a brother or sister in need, whatever it is you do to any brother or sister in this meeting, you are doing it to Christ. That's how personally Christ takes it. He's sitting at the Father's right hand and he's viewing all our interactions. Everything we do to one another, he takes personally to himself. Look at this. When you sin so against the brethren by running roughshod over them and treating their opinions and their feelings on matters as though they don't matter, when you sin so against the brethren, so all of a sudden, hang on, whoa. It started off at the beginning of chapter 8 as a question. Should we eat meat offered to idols or not? We think we can do it and it's no problem. You know, just explain to them, Paul, educate them, tell them it doesn't matter. At the end of chapter 8, it's taken on a whole different tone. This matter, which seemingly is unimportant, at the end of chapter 12, it becomes this extraordinary level of importance. These small interactions matter. Because if you treat someone with disdain in the way that you are sinning. And not only are you are sinning so against the brethren, but go further. When you wound their weak conscience, when you trample their sensitivities, you sin against Christ. So all of a sudden, this grey issue has taken on a whole different tone. And he's arguing from principle. He's trying to get us to see the real relationships that are going on here and the involvement that Christ has and the way he feels about this. When you sin so against the brethren and wound their weak conscience, you sin against Christ. What a powerful conclusion. This word wound is interesting. It's the word tupto, the Greek word tupto, and it means to thump, that is to cudgel or pummel repeatedly with repeated blows. And it means to take up a stick and whack, 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 whack someone over the head. Again, Paul is amplifying the issue. You know, it's just me saying, oh, I don't think your opinion on this matters. I've got it right. I understand the issue. You don't. We're going to do this. And in so doing, treating your brother as secondary importance. Well, in doing so, you wound their weak conscience and you pummel them over the head, this poor brother with a sensitive conscience, you're pummeling them over the head with a stick every time you treat them in this way. Now, this word only occurs a few times in the New Testament, but in very interesting contexts. Matthew 27:30, Mark 15, verse 9, Luke 22, verse 64, Matthew 24, they're the other contexts in which this word occurs. We won't turn them up, but it's all in the context of the Lord Jesus being pummeled with sticks by the Romans. When the Romans brought him before, you know, and mocked him and made fun of him and spat on him, and they put a crown of thorns on his head and humiliated him and treated him like dirt, and then they took up a stick and they took turns to beat him over the head. What the apostle is saying here, if you treat your brother in such a humiliating way, it's as though you are getting alongside the Romans and taking up that stick and belting Christ over the head. That's what that's saying. You are beating Christ over the head when you are treating your brother in that way. So all of a sudden we see the issue in a much broader and much more serious context, do we not? That the way we treat each other matters. And really, whether we're right or not, does not justify this conduct. Whether we're rationally and logically got the right answer. You know, this brother that claims to have the knowledge is in this predicament, really, beating Christ over the head with a stick like the Romans did, humiliating him. In Matthew 25, the king arrives, the judgment seat is portrayed, and the king shall answer and say unto them, verily I say to you, inasmuch as you have done it unto the one of the least of these my brethren, you have done it unto me. This is how the Lord sees it, and this is how he will view it at the judgment seat. And so, something, as I've mentioned, that is in a grey area, an area of uncertainty, we're not sure, how do we answer this question? Not sure. Paul has shown us a process of thinking whereby he arrives at this conclusion. Now, I believe he states his conclusion in verse 13 in a kind of a hyperbole, an exaggeration, to overstate the point, but to make it very clear. Therefore, on the basis of this process of thinking, if meat make my brother to offend, I will eat no flesh while the world stands, lest I make my brother to offend. How clear is that conclusion? We might argue that the meat you could eat, you know. But if it makes my brother to stumble in the truth, if it makes my brother feel in any way weakened, if it's going to cost my brother his faith, I will not eat meat while the world stands. I'm prepared to make that sacrifice. And why wouldn't we? Why wouldn't we be prepared to make such a sacrifice, given that the Lord has died for us and for that brother? And so, this word lest. Lest. If there be a chance that I make my brother to stumble. Well, that's the conclusion of chapter 8. This word offend, it's not a word that means, oh well, I've got a preference for one thing and you've got a preference for another, so I'll just bow to whatever preference you may have. It's not really matters of preference. The Greek word is scandalizo. It's got the idea of to entrap, to trip up. It's kind of like that earlier word to stumble and entice to sin. If it's going to lead our brother down a pathway which is going to lead to spiritual ruin, then there's no way on earth that we should be insisting upon our right to do something when it might lead there. This word offend is used in Matthew 18. Fascinating context. This word, same word, scandalizo. The words of Jesus now. Whoso shall offend one of these little ones which believe in me, it were better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck and that he would drown in the depths of the sea. Woe unto the world because of offences, for it must needs be that offences come, but woe to that man by whom the offence comes. Wherefore, if thy hand and foot offend thee, cut them off. If anything in your life is going to cause you or your brother to offend, says the Lord, cut it off. Sacrifice it. It's a small price to pay for the opportunity to gain eternal life. If your eye offend, pluck it out, cast it from there. It's better for thee to enter into life with one eye than having two eyes to cast into hell fire. But be aware of this. Take heed that you despise not one of these little ones. It's so important that we don't view our brothers and sisters and say, oh, well, that person's opinion doesn't matter. What do these people over here think? What do we think? You don't count. How wrong that would be. Jesus died for that brother and sister. And Jesus takes it very personally how you treat them. Take heed that you despise not one of these little ones. For, notice what he says here, I say unto you that in heaven their angels do always behold the face of my Father which is in heaven. So bear this in mind as you are treating with disdain that brother or sister over there and saying, well, their opinion doesn't matter, I don't really care what they think, I'm doing this. On a daily basis, the angel that's caring for that brother and sister, the angel that's been assigned by the Father to care for that brother and sister, is viewing the face of Almighty God in heaven and reporting on how things are going. And the angel's report goes something like this. Well, that, as you know, that brother or sister is going through a great difficulty in their lives and their faith is wavering, to be honest, because of the trials that they're facing. And their trials are considerable. And many of the ecclesia don't even know, actually, the trials that they're facing, what difficulties they have. This is the angel reporting to the Father in heaven. And, you know, things have been going pretty badly, but this brother's faith or this sister's faith is being, you know, held by some of the supportive brothers and sisters in the ecclesia. But brother so-and-so the other day, or just today actually, came up to this poor brother and said this, this and this, and it totally decimated this poor brother. And it's possible they might lose their faith. And this is the angel's report to God in heaven. Be very careful, says the Lord, that you despise not these little ones. For I say unto you that in heaven their angels, do always behold the face of my Father which is in heaven. For the Son of Man is come to save that which was lost. And so that last verse correlates with 1 Corinthians, which said, for whom Christ died. Let's think, brothers and sisters, a bit more carefully about the way we treat one another. Not just to avoid treating others badly, but to embrace the positive and to say, how much does the Lord value the care that we show to one another? Just small things, a word in season, an encouraging, empathetic conversation with someone who's going through trial. These can save, not only save lives, but save eternal lives. And think of the report of that same angel to the Father in heaven when these crucial, positive conversations take place. You know, I'll just share one thing with you on conversations. You know, there's been some studies on this, and the conclusions that they've drawn about conversations are very interesting. Sometimes the biggest changes and the most significant events in people's lives are shaped around crucial and important conversations. And so our conversations, you might think, are not that important, but actually they can make the difference in someone's life right now. And so when we, you know, close for morning tea, don't just think, oh, well, you know, we're having a bit of a break, it's morning tea. These are opportunities for you to have conversations with people who need to have these conversations, who need to be strengthened, who need to be encouraged. It's just so important that we realise that every single one of us can make a very positive difference. If we're all showing love to one another, what a strong ecclesia we would have. I'm not making any judgments about the strength of your ecclesia in respect to this. But we can all do better, can't we? Well, what an amazing conclusion we arrive at the end of chapter 8. And you say, hang on, isn't this an issue of conscience? I'm free to do what I like on this issue. Eating meats to idols is such a minor issue. Well, it takes a whole different tone, doesn't it, when we consider the ramifications of this. So Paul firstly clearly establishes that the issue is one of conscience. Then, by applying scriptural principles, he arrives at a conclusion which is clear, direct and undeniable about how someone should behave. Now, this is a model for all decisions that must be made on issues of conscience. It's not just an issue of me deciding for myself what I think I should do. You know, you can never make a decision in life which doesn't have some impact on someone else. This is particularly so if you're a parent or a grandparent or you've got any friends at all that you care anything about. The decisions you make about the things that you do in your life, whether positive or negative, impact others. And they could impact positively or negative. Now, just a couple of things to sort of shape our thinking around chapter 8 as we conclude it. The first thing I'll say is Paul never condones or recommends that a weak brother assert his conscience in order to impose his conscience on another. This should not be reversed. There's a mistake that could be made here by saying, oh, I've got an issue, I've got a weak conscience on that issue, you have to do what I want and impose that upon another. That is a misinterpretation and a total misapplication of the principle here. We must consider others. Now, in the context of 1 Corinthians 8, it was the libertines who weren't considering those with a weak conscience. But it doesn't allow the reverse to take place and for the brother with a weak conscience to say, oh, if I can hold the whole ecclesia to ransom on this issue. And then it becomes a rush to see who can be the first to say, I'm offended. And that person wins the argument. It's a complete misapplication of 1 Corinthians 8. And it's got nothing to do with showing love and concern and trying to see things from the other's point of view. That would be a misrepresentation of this chapter. So Paul's comments here are directed towards the strong brother who needed to learn to be more thoughtful of others' sensitivities. The use of chapter 8 by brethren to impose their sensitivities upon others is not recommended or condoned here by Paul and is a misuse of the chapter and a misunderstanding of the central issues. One person asserting their right to eat is not to be replaced by another asserting their right to impose their conscience on another. Paul is trying to get us to take account of everyone else's well-being, spiritual well-being, as we make these decisions in our lives. Selflessness is the theme of this chapter, not self-centeredness or self-assertiveness. Further, the word offence is not used in chapter 8 in the way we use it in the English language today. Oh, I'm offended by that. Or, you know, the colour of your hat offends me, you know, or... It's really a matter of preference in those sort of situations, not this whole idea of offence. The word offence means a stumbling block to cause to stumble. It refers to matters which are perceived by some as fundamental matters of morality, not merely matters of personal preference. However, you know, where do you draw the line? It's difficult. And again, it comes back to this golden rule. Do things for the good of others. Think of their needs before your own. And the important thing to remember in chapter 8 is Paul was protecting members who were newly introduced into the ecclesia who were really only babes in Christ and needed to be nurtured and not bullied. And the sense of Paul's words can be aligned to those in Matthew 18. Whoso shall receive one such little child in my name receives me. The way Jesus takes this personally. But whoso shall offend one of these little ones which believe in me, it were better for him to have a millstone hanged about his neck and drown in the depths of the sea. Now I want to move on to 1 Corinthians 9. We'll just get started here. And my aim is to get most of the way through Corinthians 9 this morning, and it won't be a problem. It's not as challenging as chapter 8 to explain. But it's very important that we understand that chapter 9 is linked to chapter 8. Now, Paul has just made this statement of hyperbole at the end of chapter 8, before chapter 9 begins, saying, well, if meat make my brother to offend, I won't eat meat while the world stands if it makes my brother to offend. Now, the Corinthians would have said in response to that, these strong-minded Corinthians would have said, well, Paul, they're big words, but would you really do that, give up meat for the rest of your life for the sake of your brother? I don't know. I think you're exaggerating. I think you're overstating it. We're a bit suspicious about your motives. It's all very well to say it, but would you really do it? Do we really have to sacrifice in this way? Paul, would you do that? I don't think so. And added to this, we have people in the Corinthian ecclesia accusing Paul of not being a real apostle. They're questioning Paul's credentials as an apostle. They're undermining Paul. They're saying, well, Paul's not a real apostle. There's all sorts of things he does that the real apostles don't do. There's some things he doesn't do that the real apostles do. And so he's different. And therefore, not only is he not an apostle, but we really shouldn't take seriously what he's saying. And so what Paul does in 1 Corinthians 9 is he answers both of those issues. He presents that he has not, he would not only, that's not an exaggeration, he would make that sacrifice where it required, and he's going to demonstrate that he has already done so. He has already shown them and modelled them this kind of self-sacrifice in their midst. And so chapter 9, therefore, is this incidental defence of his apostleship, whilst at the same time bringing up his own example, which they knew well while he was in their midst. And in verses 1 to 14, Paul's going to show that he had rights while he was among them that he sacrificed. He could have asked them to do things for him which he never asked them to do. And he would have been within his right to ask them to do those things, and we're going to see what they are. Paul's refusal to exercise his rights, Paul's service of all people, and Paul's self-denial and self-control. That's chapter 9. So let's just begin with a few verses here before we have to close. He says here in verse 1, "Am I not an apostle? Am I not free? Have I not seen Jesus Christ our Lord? Are not ye my work in the Lord?" Now Paul begins with these rhetorical questions, these four rhetorical questions in verse 1. In fact, there's a number of rhetorical questions. He basically makes his argument using these rhetorical questions. He's actually using the libertine rhetorical tactics here to make his point very strongly. Am I not an apostle? So this was one of the major questions to be settled as far as the Corinthians were concerned. They were denying that he was an apostle. Am I not free? This is this word liberty that keeps being thrown up by the Corinthian libertines. He's free from obligations to do certain things. He's a free man. He's not a slave. And so he could make his own decisions. So this idea of being free to make decisions is contained there, and clearly the apostle was free. Have I not seen Jesus Christ our Lord? Another question mark over the apostle. Christ ascended to heaven before the apostle was appointed to be an apostle. So what, is he really an apostle? Does he have the credentials of being an apostle? You know, the apostles had to be eyewitnesses of the life, teachings, death and resurrection of Christ. Acts chapter 1 and 22. We know that the apostles had to be able to be eyewitnesses so they could go around the world and preach, "I've seen the risen Lord." Did the apostles see the risen Lord? And this was a question that they raised. Of course, we know that the apostle did receive the commission on the road to Damascus and had appearances by the Lord to him, even in Corinth, actually, where Jesus appeared to him and said, "I have much people in this city." But nevertheless, they tried to question the apostle's credentials. And then the last question is, "Are not ye my work in the Lord?" Now, Paul makes the point here by this question, saying, I can understand some people questioning the legitimacy of my apostleship, but you, I established the ecclesia. I came there preaching when there was not a brother or a sister to be found in Corinth. You are the fruits of my labour as an apostle, and you are questioning the legitimacy of my apostleship. Can you see the irony? You are questioning the very foundations of your faith in asking such a question. He goes on in verse 2, "If I be not apostle to others, doubtless I am to you. For the seal of mine apostleship are ye in the Lord." Paul had spent 18 months among them. Many of them owed their conversion to his work. They owed their understanding of the gospel to his teaching. And so the apostle said, "How ironic is it that you, of all people, are questioning my apostleship? You, in fact, rather than being a source of doubt, should be seen as the seal, that is, the stamp of authenticity." You know, the king's seal that they used on letters, saying, boom, this is the king's letter. They used to have wax and go with the king's ring, whack, authentic. You are the source of authenticity of my apostleship, and yet here you are questioning it. And then he says, my answer, verse 3, "to them that do examine me is this." And so they're accusing people, they're accusing the apostle of missing some of the key features of an apostle. And not only that, questioning Paul's genuineness and integrity and whether he'd really make the sacrifices which he's trying to get them to make in relation to eating meat. And so he goes on here in verse 5, and he says, "Have we not power?" This is this word exousia or liberty that's used in the previous chapter in, say, verse 9. this liberty of yours? Have we not liberty or power or the right to lead about a sister, a wife, as well as the other apostles and as the brethren of the Lord and Cephas? What's he saying here? Of course the Apostle Paul had the right to get married. No one's questioning that. That's not the issue. The issue here is that Peter had a wife, the other brethren of the Lord had a wife, and by brethren of the Lord he means Jesus' half-brothers, James, Joseph, Simon, Judas, Matthew 13, verse 55. Now, these brothers, whilst during Christ's ministry, were unconvinced by the messiahship of the Lord. After the resurrection, they became totally convinced and leaders in the first century ecclesia. And James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas clearly all had wives, just as Cephas did, and they travelled around the ecclesias with their wives and asked for contributions from those ecclesias towards travelling expenses, food, accommodation. That's what's being spoken about here. Not the right to marry, but the right to lead about a wife and to ask for expenses and food and accommodation as they travelled around the ecclesial world. This was the custom. Or, verse 6, or I only and Barnabas have we not power to forbear working. What he's saying there is that Barnabas and myself, we are single, we're not married. Are we the only ones of all these ones I've mentioned that don't have the right to ask for expenses as we travel around the ecclesial world? And then he goes on in verse 7, who goes to warfare at any time at his own charges? Who plants a vineyard and eats not the fruit thereof? Or who feeds a flock and eats not the milk thereof? He gives three examples here of things that go on in life where payments are made for work done. Who goes to warfare? Who becomes a soldier at his own expense? You know, when people advertise to come into the army, they don't say, oh, come into the army and bring some money to buy your own uniforms and your own weapons and you're going to pay for everything. No, just turn up in the clothes you're wearing, put your clothes over there, here's a uniform, here's your gun, here's your food, you'll even get salary along the way, we will pay everything, you're giving your life to the service, so we will look after you and meet your means while you're doing so. That happens in the army. And what about the worker in the vineyard? Well, the worker in the vineyard also has entitlement to support from the vineyard in which they're working. So they get paid and they get expenses paid and so on. And the same with a flock. In those days, the shepherds that cared for a flock actually got their income from a share of the flock. As well as an income day by day, they got a share of the fruits of the flock. So, you know, there was buy-in. And so what he's saying here is these are examples from daily life that say that people that are engaged in the work to the benefit of others need to be supported by that work itself. Say are these things, he says here, as a man, or saith the law not the same also? So the first three examples are like from daily life. Then he says, does the Bible teach this? He says in verse 9, for it is written in the law of Moses, thou shalt not muzzle the mouth of the ox that treads out the corn. That's a principle in the law. The cow gets to eat of the food that falls at its feet as it's working. Doth God care for oxen? Did God put that in the law because he cares for oxen? Or did he put that in the law to teach us a lesson? Verse 10. Doth God care for oxen? Or does he say that for our sakes? For our sakes, no doubt it is written, so that we might learn a lesson that he that ploughs should plough in hope, and that he that threshes in hope should be partaker of his hope. If we have sown, therefore, unto you spiritual things, is it a great thing if we reap carnal things? If others be partakers of this power over you, are not we the rather? So what the apostle is establishing here is that he has a right to expect, as he goes around the ecclesial world, a spiritual, scriptural right, and as we see in the world just from the soldier and the vineyard keeper and the shepherd and so on, that it would be reasonable for the Corinthians to say, Paul, while you're here, we'll feed you, we'll accommodate you, we'll pay your expenses, your travel expenses. You're working on our behalf. We will look after you. And they did it for Peter. They did it for the brethren of the Lord who travelled. They not only did it for them, but for their wives. That's reasonable, and surely that's our practice now, isn't it, brothers and sisters? I mean, Cumberland have paid my airfare here. You know, I didn't turn up here under my own steam just because I wanted to come, you know, just it was my idea. You invited me and you paid my expenses and I hope I get to share in the lunch. This is reasonable behaviour, isn't it? We understand that, and that's what the apostle's saying here. And I'm going to leave it there and we'll take it up in our next session and continue on to see what he's got to say about this.
BibleTruthAndProphecy.com is a worldwide collaboration by Christadelphians to help promote the understanding of God's Word to those who are seeking the truth about the human condition and God's plan and purpose with this earth and with mankind upon it. Bible Truth and Prophecy is part of a wider set of online resources provided by Christadelphianvideo.org. For establishing just how far removed the true Christian teaching of the first century apostles is from that taught by mainstream Christendom today. BibleTruthAndProphecy.com is very much a standalone website, but benefits from our vast network of sites and resources and social media. Here are just a few of the things that BibleTruthAndProphecy.com offers. We have a good number of written articles supplied to us from brothers from all over the globe. These deal with first principle issues, creation versus evolution, the inspiration of the Bible, and so much more. We have a whole section of video study series. These are studies that have been posted onto our YouTube channel, but because of the difficulty of the search feature within YouTube, we have chosen to host on Bible Truth and Prophecy. So now, every video you search for within the site, you can be guaranteed that it will be of a Christadelphian nature. We also have a preaching video section, where any ecclesia is invited to download and use or embed these videos within their own ecclesial websites. We also have an exhortation service, where we produce two or three exhortations per week, which we then circulate to brethren and sisters in isolation. We also have an ever-growing list of approved Christadelphian sites. We also have a page of live news feeds, so you can keep up to date with all the breaking news as it happens. We also have a section for the daily readings. Each day at around midnight, we publish all three of the daily readings. And then later on in the day, we publish Thought for the Days, often based on all three portions of the daily readings. Within each daily reading post, there is also a link to enable you to have the Bible chapter read to you directly. We also feature Bible in the News videos, videos which we have produced from the Bible in the News website. We also feature Brother Don Pierce's milestone snippets, which come out approximately three times a week. We also feature Andy Walton's weekly World Watch, and other commentaries and analysis from other brethren on world news events. You can also subscribe to the blog and be notified of posts as they happen in real time, and also subscribe to the weekly newsletter which is provided by Christadelphianvideo.org. Every page and post on the site has the facility to be able to leave a comment or make an observation, so please take advantage of this and let us know what you think of the site.